Hello, well, welcome to the New York School of Feng Shui orientation. So our program begins in October, and this curriculum has been running for over 20 years now, probably around 25 years. And my initial background with this material is through traditional Chinese medicine. So I was involved with the East-West Center in London, and I was studying Shiatsu and macrobiotics and lots of other sort of Taoist modalities, martial arts, etc. And way back then, there was only one or two books on Feng Shui, so I had already started quite a fascination with the subject. So 25 years ago, there was two books on Feng Shui, and there was, of course, no schools that you could go to, so you really had to be a very keen self-learner, which I became. So I studied a little bit of Nine Star Qi with Michio Kushi, which was an introduction to using the I Ching as a system of astrology. However, when I went back to Australia, because I was living in London at that time, when I went back to Australia, I started a school there where we taught the eight rays of traditional Chinese medicine. So my school had a curriculum that had food energetics, so we had a whole self-healing program, and I was running the cooking school. I was running the diploma course in Shiatsu massage. We integrated the Chinese herbs. We had weekends of acupuncture training for our Shiatsu students. We had various martial arts that we were training people in, for instance, Aikido and Tai Chi and Qigong, and a system of massage called Douyin. And we had various sort of counseling programs, etc. And Feng Shui. So Feng Shui is part of those eight rays of traditional Chinese medicine, Feng Shui and cosmological thinking, or if you like, astrology. So the Taoist philosophical core is an understanding of how the universe operates and your position in that. And what they use is yin and yang, the five elements, the 10 heavenly stems, and the 12 earthly branches. And they also use a system of numerology that's referred to as the Lo Shu, which is a system of the eight trigrams and the nine numbers. So that's the core, philosophical core, that gets applied to the body. So applying those mandalas, or that system of understanding the universe, when you apply that, you can understand how they started to figure out all the meridians over the body. They started to figure out the organs and the relationship of the organs to colors and shapes and directions and certain ailments. And of course, that's the very deep wisdom of traditional Chinese medicine applied to the internal landscape. Now, once you start to understand those core principles, you can then apply it to Feng Shui. So my training in acupuncture, I came across all of these mandalas, and some of the teachers at the acupuncture school were interested in Feng Shui. So I was able to spend some time with them, and I started to understand a little bit of Chinese, and I started to decode the Chinese almanac. So that in the Chinese culture, there's a book that's released every year, millions are sold, and that's a book of all of the cosmological patterning and the cycles of change and the trigrams, etc. And the eight trigrams I started to put into the context of the Southern Hemisphere, because I was in Australia and I was totally fascinated with how the system, which developed in China and obviously had the logic of the energy flow of the Northern Hemisphere, which is essentially the sun. A lot of Feng Shui is geared up for the sun. The sun's pattern, as you know, it rises in the east, goes high to the south, sinks in the west, and goes low to the north. That's why the Chinese feng shui maps always have south written at the top. because that's the most yang position. So I knew straight away, just through pure Taoist logic, and there's a lot of logic in Taoist thinking, that the Bagua and the trigrams and the basic energy grids that we use in Feng Shui, we have to actually start to make changes for the Southern Hemisphere. So with that challenge, I had to really start to get in and decode all of these Taoist patterns. And I had a little bit of a gift for doing that. One of my favorite subjects that I had a couple of years also at university with was mathematics. And I was always fascinated with the patterns of numbers. So I spent quite a few years starting to obviously work with the form school, and then started to work with some of these more techniques that we use in Feng Shui that are called the compass school techniques. And then within a couple of years I started a curriculum. And as it turned out, I was the first curriculum to be established in the West, outside of China, that was a classical Feng Shui curriculum. And I'll explain that a little bit more, because Feng Shui has a few different schools to it. In the meantime, some of the Black Sect books started to come out. Now we're into the late 80s and the early 90s, and the Black Sect is from Professor Lin Yong, who recently passed away, and he was a teacher here in the States. And he started to popularize Feng Shui. And a lot of American students started this program, and they started to write lots of books. And the first book was by Sarah Rosbach. And that started to create a tremendous amount of interest. Now, I always call Feng Shui the last kid on the block. And what I mean by that is 100 years ago, we had acupuncture coming from the East to the West. And then in the 60s, we had with the hippie generation, we had macrobiotics and Eastern thought and Taoism and meditation. And then in the 70s, we had martial arts being developed. And by the late 80s, we had a lot of institutions that were starting to teach acupuncture and Chinese medicine and herbalism and so forth. Then by the end of the 80s, in early 90s, we were ready for the last wave of Eastern philosophy, and that was Feng Shui. The art and science of how to apply this to the environment, or to buildings, to our houses, to make them more balanced, make them more harmonious, and make them more inviting to tap into and to help us tap into the potentials of our life. Just like we study, food as medicine or exercise, it's to tap in to the potentials of our life. And Feng Shui really, really helps with that. So anyway, come long story short, in the 90s I was invited all over the world, because essentially a lot of people started to become interested in Feng Shui, and I already had a written curriculum and was teaching it. And so I started classical Feng Shui training. In the meantime, there's a lot of Black Sect training, and they do, the system's a little bit different with them. They don't use directions, and they don't use a lot of compass school techniques. Whereas when you look at classical Feng Shui, it's the way Feng Shui practitioners in Hong Kong and in China and Taiwan do this art. So I got invited to Austria and Germany and Switzerland, and I was running schools in London, and I for many years I ran a school in San Francisco, and I taught in many cities around Australia and of course New Zealand, and essentially I've ended up teaching over 70 countries and probably 100 cities. And in the meantime, over the last 15 odd years, I sponsored over 10 international feng shui and ecology and sacred geometry conferences, as well as putting on several feng shui tours to China. In fact, I organized historically the first international feng shui tour to China, and that was in about 1996. So I've got a lot of fascinating stories about that. And of course, I felt at the time that here I am, a pioneer in the art of feng shui in the West, so it was really, really important to go back to the heartland of this, which is China, and to meet the practitioners. I organized seminars for them to teach all of our Western students, and many tours through China and Hong Kong, and met dozens and dozens of practitioners. And I was able to, you know, there's always a few little gray areas in my curriculum, and of course I was able to really, really fine-tune my curriculum. So now the program is pretty much just run here in New York, the New York School. It means that I don't have to travel around so much. I'm not teaching so much in Europe and Australia so much. I still do some activities in Prague, which was actually where I started my first Feng Shui and Ecology conference back in the late 90s. And one important thing here, my conferences were always referred to as Feng Shui, Ecology, and Sacred Geometry, because here we have this beautiful metaphysical understanding that we call Feng Shui, and then we had to combine that with our eco-design and all the wonderful sustainability, which Feng Shui has been on the cutting edge of that. It was the Feng Shui activities that really made architects and mainstream start to think about buildings as becoming more healthy and more balanced and more integrated into the environment. So the whole eco and sustainable design movement has been coming along with the Feng Shui movement. And I've been active in promoting that, and also sponsoring many teachers, and like for instance permaculture and so forth. And the other thing here, the other little clue here to getting the whole picture, is our Western heritage with this, and that's called sacred geometry. It's kind of like the Western feng shui. Now, sacred geometry is a very deep understanding of the ratios and the patterns of nature and of the way the universe operates, the way chi or prana operates, and it gives us a little bit more of a scientific understanding of, you know, energy or vibration. And historically, our ancestors, as well as in the East, by the way, they use these ratios and proportions for all of their classical architecture. So when you look at a Vedic temple in India and how beautiful it is, it's all done with sacred geometry. The feng shui, or their system of feng shui called Vastu Sastra, which I put on about 4 international tours to India studying Vastu Sastra. It's very similar to feng shui in the sense it's the environmental energy and the orientations and the culture and the symbolism coming in with the architectural classical techniques of ratios and proportions. So when you start to study all of that, you really start to have a very powerful tools to start to help your clients. Now, this curriculum is about you becoming confident as a feng shui practitioner, so that you can start to work with people on any kind of level. And what I mean by that is you can come in and help somebody adjust the energy of their home, in the bedroom, in the kitchen, and you can help an architect or somebody designing a new place, integrating all the feng shui principles. In this curriculum, we also bring in things like space clearing, and working with electromagnetic fields. Now, electromagnetic fields is a sort of a new toxin in our culture now, and we really need to educate people about that as well. So this curriculum covers a lot of ground. It's structured into 6 modules, and one of them is sacred geometry, which you can watch anytime as an online module. Now, I'm going to give you just a little bit of an introduction to feng shui, to get some of the terminology across, introduce you to a little bit of some of the techniques, and then I'm going to show you a PowerPoint that we can go through again some of this material, and you can get to know what this curriculum is all about. So the word feng shui means wind and water, and an older name of feng shui is actually called Kanyu, K-A-N-Y-U. K-A-N-Y-U. So it's a bit of a joke. It's like, can you do feng shui? There you go. And this word is very, very interesting. This is what you find in all of the classics. Right, this word here. It wasn't until about 260 AD there was a writer called Gua Po, and he was the first one to coin this term feng shui. And he described it very, very beautifully about how wind is symbolic of the qi or invisible energy, and water is symbolic of the tangible force, and it's gathering the qi and holding it and containing it. Right. We'll talk about that in a minute, but this word here was used historically a lot, and basically it translates as heaven and earth. So this word can in Chinese actually translates closer to the meaning of an umbrella. Now, when you look at an umbrella, it's like looking at the horizon and all of the energetic forces that we receive from our solar system, from our galaxies, and essentially from the infinite universe, which we generally refer to a lot as metaphysics, cosmology, or astrology. So that was the metaphysical aspect, the study and the pattern of heaven. And the Taoists were really good at that. This philosophy is very elegant and very clear and very precise about the pattern of heaven. And we really get into that in this curriculum. You learn a lot about the universe that we live in. Now, Yu was a word that we can closely describe as earth, but it's actually a little bit more closer to geology, in the sense that this was the study of all of the earth patterns, the rock formations, the mountains, the rivers, the quality of the soil. Don't forget, this was very much an agricultural community that this art and science came from. So they're very geared up for making successful crops and making very successful shelters and so forth. Now, the word feng shui came later. Feng Shui, you can pronounce it however you like, but it basically means wind and water. And the best way to think about that is qi, or energy that's more yang, is like wind, moving, vibrational qi. And water is more tangible, or more yin qi, physical qi. So we're constantly using yin and yang in this, in the sense that yang and yin are the main principles that we use to begin with, and then everything else is just a lot of detail of that. Now, this is where the terminology, the so-called compass school, that you've probably heard about, you know, those people, I'm sure you've read some books, and compass school and the form school. So classical feng shui is made up of the study of the compass and the form school. So that's what I based my curriculum on. So in the sense that, yes, we'll start with the core principles of yin and yang, and you know, you'll really get to know yin and yang like the back of your hand in this curriculum. And throughout this curriculum, I also give you ideas about how to apply yin and yang into other aspects of your life, as well as your physical, emotional, and spiritual health. And we also discuss aspects of traditional Chinese medicine and food energetics and so forth. You might be familiar with my other curriculum that's called the Academy of Healing Nutrition. And if you do this curriculum, by the way, you get a 20% discount if you decide to do the Academy of Healing Nutrition. Both of those curriculums really entwine very much and bounce off each other very, you know, they complement each other very, very well. So here's the more yang aspect, the more yin. So generally speaking, we're going to call this the compass school, and this is the form school. Now, the compass school is made up of some very, very interesting techniques. You've probably all heard of the Ba Gua. This word Ba means eight in Chinese, and Gua is a word that can mean side, it can mean like a trigram, etc. So eight trigrams, right? Or eight energies, right? So this came from the study of the, in English you'll see that written a lot like this, I Ching, really, and it's Yi Jing is more authentic. And of course, the trigrams themselves are anything from a yang, three yang lines to three yin lines. So there's a number of techniques that you learn in this curriculum. The Bagua, the Mingua system, very important. Classical Feng Shui, which is your destiny number now. So it's your introduction to the astrology. There's the Ba Zai system that you'll be learning. And you'll be learning the Flying Star system. Flying Star is a very, very fascinating system where we start to look at time and space and we put that into the design and recommendations and problem solving of a dwelling. Amazing, very exciting technique to learn. And integrated into this is the total system of astrology called the Four Pillars. The Four Pillars is the complete Chinese astrology, as one of the pioneers of that. And I'm famous for my workbooks. I'm famous for my workbooks for all of this. The curriculum has wonderful workbooks, and particularly with the Four Pillars. The Four Pillars is not much information around with it, and a little bit hard to get the calculations through, but the workbook takes you, you know, step by step through these calculations. A lot of information that I've been able to gather over 25 years now. I've had to be a detective of the Four Pillars horoscope. And then over here we've got the Form School, which is where we start with all of this. Module 1. So Module 1, we go into, okay, what's the basic feng shui design? What's yin and yang applied to your house? What's the five elements applied to your house? We look, start to think and learn about colors and shapes and basic energy patterns. And I take you through what's called a room-by-room analysis. So we start to look at, well, what is the feng shui ideas of the bedroom, the kitchen, you know, the storage areas. You know, we talk about furniture and qi movement, and we start to do some feng shui design. Right? And you start to learn the basic concepts that you'll come across and use a lot in feng shui, and that's called sha qi and shen qi. So very simply, sha qi is a little bit like the negative, aggressive energy that we have to protect ourselves from, and shen qi is the more gentle, vibrational, spiraling energy of nature that we really, really celebrate. So basically, feng shui is about maximizing the shen qi and minimizing the sha qi. And you need to study these two terms and get to know them very well and get to know how to enhance this and how to balance this out. So that's some of the terminology and introducing you to some of the techniques. Form School, Module 1, Module 2, we go into the study everything to study about the nine numbers, the eight trigrams, the Bagua system, and the Ba Zai, Mingua, and Flying Star. Module 3, we go into the Four Pillars. So we get a lot of that information done within the first 3 months. Then I have a module that's more practical. So we'll be doing a little bit of revision in that module, and we'll be then doing some practical work, taking this out and applying it to houses, etc. And throughout the curriculum, you'll be getting to know how to use the Lopan compass. So this is a compass that I was involved with. This one was manufactured in Switzerland. Unfortunately, it's no longer available. But essentially, I was the first person to create an English Lopan compass. And the way that happened was, this pretty much started off as just like an empty template, and I'd have students come in and give them a template and some colouring pens, and we'd go through this compass and start to create our own compass. But that sort of like took a whole day to do. And then when I was teaching in Switzerland, the students there said, hey, you know, let's get together and start to put together a more sophisticated compass. And my compass was the first, not only the first compass in English, but it was the first low-pan compass that started to colour code things, like with green for wood and red for fire and so forth. Anyway, my whole intention was always to make this information very accessible to you and to Western students, because it can be quite a confusing subject if you start to, you know, read, you know, if you read more than 6 or 7 feng shui books, you'll be probably very confused by now. With this curriculum, you don't need to read any books. My workbooks sort of cover it all. Not that you don't read books, and I'll be certainly making some good recommendations to you about some of the books to read, but it pretty much is a self-contained curriculum. You get to know how to use this. Now, you don't have to get something like this. These days, it's really neat. On your iPhone, you can actually download a low-pan compass on your iPhone, and you just use that to get the reading. It's a very important aspect. You know, the sign of the feng shui practitioner was to understand orientation and to understand the sitting and the facing of a dwelling and how to do a low-pan compass reading, because a lot of those techniques depend on you being able to do this. So I train you well on that. But getting just a simple low-pan compass, you don't need anything as fancy as this these days. But anyway, that's like a low-pan compass that we had for many, many years, and we produced this lovely little book, no longer available, totally out of print now. So what we'll do is I'll set up my PowerPoint, and we'll go through, you know, some more aspects of the curriculum, and then we'll take you through this PowerPoint presentation. New York School, Feng Shui, welcome to the orientation evening. So you've already learned a little bit about me, you know, with this PowerPoint I'll be able to take you through some more logistics and dynamics of the curriculum. So again, my passion for the subject has been for like the last 25 years teaching hundreds of students, pretty much starting the first and longest established classical feng shui curriculum. I love taking students on a journey, you know, from the beginning, middle to the end. These are very, very intensive modules, but with the workbooks, and the workbooks also have like some question and answers exercises at the back, so you're able to consolidate the information as you go along. But it is an intensive program, but you know, there's not too much work that you have to do between the modules, except, you know, work and start to apply this to yourself. So it's very much a experiential curriculum in that sense. Later on, when we do some of the compass techniques, yes, you have to practice it and study it and so forth. And there is a revision exam that we do. After the first three modules, pretty much all of the theory is done in the first three modules. And then my fourth module is more practical, but we do the last day, we do the revision exam, which I give to you. And you do that at home and you bring it back to the class, and also you bring a project back to the fourth module. Now, I'll be explaining a little bit more about that in class, obviously, but for now, as an introduction, essentially you start to work with a client and you document it, and you bring it to class and we're able to assess it, and it's just another way of you becoming confident to be able to do feng shui. So that's the fourth module. My fifth module is more advanced, four pillars, and we also use that module as revision. There's a lot of material here that you need to get familiar with, so there's plenty of time in this curriculum to, you know, go back a few steps and to look at other areas and to review and to keep integrating the material. And then, of course, the sixth module is the sacred geometry module. So, you know, what is feng shui? Well, we've already mentioned Can Yu, and my workbooks have got some really, really interesting history to feng shui. And also, it's not an isolated subject. You know, things like face reading and I Ching and divination and astrology. And there's lots and lots of little more topics that make up the world of feng shui. And then, of course, this whole goal of integrating what's called the San Chai, or the three treasures that you see here, heaven, earth, and humanity, which is the way the cosmos is created. A very, very important, powerful Taoist principle is the San Chai, or the three treasures, or heaven, earth, and humanity. And that's what these feng shui techniques are made up of. And that's basically the framework that we operate from. Okay, and of course, the principles of feng shui can be applied to what we call the fractal universe. We see ourselves as part of our body, and we start to see our body as part of our home. And we see the home as embedded into the environment, and into our culture, and into our planet, and into our solar system. So, you know, it's a big picture study of our place within the universe that we live in. We get to know how to start to analyze sites in terms of Shen Qi. I've mentioned this a little bit before. The positive energy and how to capture that and generate that in the design. That's what we do. We love Shen Qi, we adore it, we pray to it, we bow to it, we maximize it. And we get to know how to adjust the negative stagnant energy or aggressive energy and so forth. So how to mitigate these challenges. And that's generally what we call the feng shui remedies, feng shui solutions. Again, in module one, we go through all of the remedies and solutions and the feng shui cures and so forth. And of course, getting to know yin and yang, you know, cold and hot, and energy more to the center is yin, and energy more to the periphery is yang, and even numbers, odd numbers, and so forth. And you get to know how to apply that onto the home. So now you start to see the northern hemisphere, sun's pattern here, the hot area of the house, the south, and the colder the north, the east, the west. This is where these trigrams have come from. They've come from not only the vibrational, but the quality of those directions based on the sun's energy. So I love to be able to decode those trigrams for you and make you understand where they've come from and how they got to writing them in that way. Here's a mandala that we use in terms of here's the 12 animal signs you might be a little bit familiar with here, the rat, the ox, the tiger, etc. That's part of the Lopan compass, and of course we start to use these animal signs, the 12 animal signs, in terms of studying the person's horoscope, referred to as the four pillars. And we really get into time, you know, in the sense of we really start to study the not only the flow of the sun that we have here, but also the whole idea of time. Now here's some basic feng shui terminology: the black turtle, the red bird, the dragon, and the tiger. So you get to know how to design with that. And of course the five elements: wood, fire, earth, metal, water. You'll get to know the five elements like the back of your hand. It will be tattooed onto you. That's how well you have to get to know the five elements. So I introduce that in module one, and we work with that throughout. And of course I've got some wonderful extra materials about the five elements applied to everything. So it's fun to play with, because we start to play with forms and shapes and energy flows and the feelings of the space. You know, what kind of message is it giving to him? But you learn how to start to analyze that in terms of feng shui. And the animal signs and trigrams, you get to know directions and how to apply directionology onto a site. Each property is different. You get to know the barzai and how to start to read energy grids like this, called the flying star. Again, I mentioned this before, very dynamic, fun technique to work with. Very, a little bit more advanced, but we start to learn that in module 2. And I've got a very good workbook for you with that one. So sustainable living environments I integrate throughout the curriculum. You'll learn those basic principles. And space clearing, clutter clearing, of course, in module 1, very, very important. You know, the whole thing about this is learning and getting inspired to start to do this in your own life. Start to clear out all the old junk and all the old stagnation that's kind of like holding you back. It's a bit of a problem in our culture, as you know. We just have too much stuff and we're just overly materialistic, and it starts to really block our energy flow and kind of keep us down. So on a basic level, we start to work with things like that, and of course helping your clients. We bring in aspects of, you know, face reading, how to look at the face and the different organs that you can, you know, where the kidneys, the heart are, and the general health of the person we can read from the face. And as I mentioned before, I also bring in aspects of food energetics, natural healing. Sacred geometry is just an amazing subject. From time to time, I do other sponsorships, you know, on alchemy, or getting other teachers, running a few more other weekends or modules on sacred geometry. So you always just need to check the website, fengshuiseminars.com. On the home page there, you'll always see what's coming up in terms of workshops and seminars. And I will be making this a lot more available as an online learning. I filmed many, many sponsorships and tours that I did with sacred geometry, so we'll have a lot more of that available soon in terms of online training. And these are pictures from a dear friend, Michael Rice, who's been working with me for many years. He actually did this training 15 years ago, and we've been friends ever since. And he does these wonderful designs. But your module that you'll be working with sacred geometry is with Mark Hampf and Marnie Muller, and they're from Asheville, North Carolina, here in the States. And they've put together a wonderful little package on sacred geometry focused for the feng shui practitioner. So they start to decode a lot of the feng shui patterns and mandalas in terms of sacred geometry. They do this wonderful analysis of the Forbidden Palace using sacred geometry and the golden mean ratio. The golden mean ratio you have to learn as a designer. Most architects don't even know what you're talking about. They never use it now. It was what all classically trained architects used all the time, because it brings in these relationships of what we call beauty and harmony into a design. So you'd be learning that, and then you can start to apply it to different design attributes. So that's sacred geometry. A wonderful subject to integrate into feng shui. You know, feng shui, great place to, you know, get into, motivate you to start to make changes in your life and to be able to help other people. And, you know, people get a lot of you know, buzz out of this curriculum, and it helps them to sort of catalyze change in their life. Our website pretty much goes into detail about our program here, but you know, essentially it's the 4-day modules, Saturday through to Tuesday. Now the reason why we have that is if you have a full-time job and you know you're wanting to just attend Saturday and Sunday, you can, and then Monday and Tuesday you can watch online, right? Now of course you can do this program completely in-house here, and you can do this program completely as an online training as well, or you can do a combination of both, in the sense of do some online or do half online, half in class, or any combination you wish. It's very, very flexible. Of course, the course fees is pretty straightforward, full payment. Otherwise, we do have a payment plan over, you know, 6 to 10 months if you wish. And if you put a deposit down on the course. We'll give you like a little bit of a discount tonight if you sign up. And if you've got any questions, I am happy to answer them for you. We'll turn the camera off now because questions get a little bit, you know, you can't hear them and so forth. But I'd like to thank you all coming this evening, and I hope that some of you are going to be considering doing the program. We're going to make this available online, so those watching this online, you can always send an email and ask us any questions. And so thank you very much.